Mark Tatum, Deputy Commissioner and COO of the National Basketball Association.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here with you all.
Dr. Richard Lapchick, thanks for being with us here on R&R on Sports.
Thank you for having me.
Civil rights icon, Dr. Edwards, how are you today?
I'm doing a heck of a lot better than I deserve, I'll tell you that.
Sports commentator, Scoop Jackson.
Good to be back on with you all.
Ian Griffey Jr., how are you today, sir?
I'm good. How about you guys?
It's R&R on Sports.
R&R on Sports.
Hello and welcome to R&R on Sports. My name is Howard Robertson.
And I am Mr. Fantastical, the awesome, the Mr. Grandiloquent, Larry Robinson. What's up, America?
What's up, man? The Grandiloquent. How you doing,
hey,
man?
Hey, man, I'm starting to see. It's the Grandiloquent. It's that Grandiloquent.
What does that mean? Give me the definition real quick.
Dramatic. Dramatic. Bombastic. Expressive. Listen, don't be
bombastic.
Testing my...
No, that was Shaggy, man. You don't...
Mr. Bombastic.
Don't try to steal Shaggy stuff.
Man, I can be bombastic. I'm from Louisville, brother. You know, you got to get up on this now. Don't back up off me now. Keep your distance.
Okay.
Keep your social distance.
Yeah,
keep your social distance.
Absolutely.
You got your mask? Where your mask at?
My mask is right here.
Okay. Right. Woo, look at him with the cap out for side, man. Look at you. Don't be trying to be
putting on my headset.
Yeah, don't be trying to do all that. Don't be trying to do all that. We need the people to hear you today.
I got my stuff. Where's yours?
We got a lot. Mine is sitting right here, but I don't need to prove it to anybody. I don't need to prove it to anybody.
Okay.
No, man. Don't be trying to put me in the same category as the president, man. I'm not saying I'm lying and carrying on. You and CNN. Trying to, you know,
saying, yeah, because if his lips are moving, he's lying.
Have you ever seen anybody?
You know what? In terms of books, I was somewhere and I saw a young guy that had The Room Where It Happens, which is the book, big 600 page War and Peace looking book by what's her name?
The niece?
No, the niece has another book.
Right.
And that's the one I want to read.
I want to read about how
he paid somebody to take his SAT.
Right.
So he could get in the pit.
Well, I just know he got about five words in his vocabulary. China.
Yeah.
China. China.
Those are two. China. Yes.
Really be.
Let's see.
Really,
number
really
three.
Be.
Number three would be me. Number four would be I. Number five would be greatest.
You think we should send the president to the bubble?
No, man. Why they want him up in there?
Well, you know, I mean, they say it's the safest
place.
You
better send plenty of Secret Service with him.
Oh, boy.
You send him because they do something to him up in there.
No, they would.
Yes,
not
they would. Yes, they would.
You think so?
Yes, they would.
Oh, wow.
Somebody would do something to
him. So tell me, man, what's going on?
Well,
what's on you this weekend?
Well, I think this show is going to be a fantastic show because we're going to be able to talk about the name of this show is The Name of the Game is Change. Because
help
when you look,
that.
Name of the game is change. Because when you look around the entire landscape of sports,
okay,
everything is changing.
Absolutely.
All right.
Absolutely.
I know you want to talk about the Redskins.
I don't know what the R word is. Washington. Watch your mouth, man. Because I'm part Cherokee.
Oh,
I'm part Cherokee.
You ain't covered. Yeah, every our brother's got some Indian in them.
Absolutely, absolutely.
But it's all about change. So many things in sports are changing across the entire landscape.
Yeah.
And so we're going to talk about a lot of those things today. But, I mean, that is probably the latest, I guess, the Redskins.
Well,
the
you know,
Washington
the,
name.
Yeah, well, check it out, man. See, I've all, you know, if you've been listening to R&R, you know I've been talking about this issue for a long
time. For years.
Time.
Literally years.
I've had an issue with this name for a long time. And I want to say, at this point, why now? In your opinion, why now?
In my opinion?
What happened to make every single thing and every single person all of a sudden feel like this name is improper, disrespectful to the Aboriginal people of this piece of land?
Well, I think it's the same epiphany and the same quote-unquote enlightenment that so many other people get. And I can't answer that. I don't know what it is, but everybody seemed to get the same email and whatnot.
Everybody got religion at the same time.
At the same time. Yeah. That said,
I've been slain in the spirit. I'm slain in the spirit. I got to repent for all my sins.
Now, I mean, you know, that's ridiculous,
it
man.
Is.
I mean, because it's basic human decency. It's really looking at your fellow man and saying, I respect you. I respect your history.
So one word answer. Do you think it is sincere and comes from the heart?
I don't think anything that any NFL owner does is sincere.
So no, we'll be back on the other side and we're going to talk about a lot of stuff, but we'll be back for more.
Just the two of us.
Right after this.
On our own sports. It's just the two of us. Ain't no guests today.
Hey, this is Dr. J.
This is Shaq Adocious.
Yo, what's up? This is Ice Cube.
And you're listening to a little R&R on sports.
Funking up your airwaves and jamming the good information in your ear. Once again, it's Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Good morning and welcome to the pre-NFL pre-draft money management seminar. Most of you in this room are about to sign some very lucrative contracts. In this session should be extremely helpful in making important money management decisions. Our first speaker is Mr. Uncle Regis Robinson, and he'll be speaking to you about ways to support your community. The podium is all yours, Mr. Uncle Regis Robinson.
Well, good morning, everyone. And today I want to talk with y'all about how to support your community with all this money y'all about to come into. So I want to give y'all three important tips on how to manage your money and support community. And y'all need to take notes on this now. Number one, always get your check and get it cash. Get your money in your hand and have them count it out. Now go down there to Willie Earl's Liquor Store or whosoever the name is of the store in your community that's been cashing your mama and your drunk uncle's check for years. They'll cash your check and count it out in your hand. Now, Uncle Willie Earl or whosoever might have to write a few hot checks to get the cash to cash your big check, but don't worry about that. He know what to do. And make sure you get about $5,000 in ones for walking around money. You know stankin' them gonna be asking you to let them hold something. Plus, you can make it rain like hell at the club for Luscious and Big T Tonya. Keep that money in your community. Number two, don't put your money in no bank. Bury your money in the backyard. First, you invest in a badass dog. Now, Percy Joe done bred up a male pit bull with a female gorilla. He calls them pit rillas. Buy you one or two of them pit rillas, and up under the doghouse, you install this. See, this is the Uncle Regis Underground Money Vault, patent pending. Complete with sound system, a safe, lighting, and a table and a bar. And the front door is the floor of the doghouse. Number three, don't move to the suburbs. Stay in your community. Take the money from your first check and buy up Pookies, Ray Rays, Nuck Nuck, Boquishas, and Quinterius's them houses. Knock all of them down. Then build your house and then build you a mall. Put in a nail shop, a weave salon, barber shop, shoe store, and sell some lottery tickets and your own personal museum. Woo-wee, it's gonna be something else. Thank y'all very much. And please see the representatives in the hallway for your check cashing card and your reservations for Pit Rillas, the Money Vault, and the Real Estate Rep.
You're listening to R&R on Sports. And don't forget to subscribe and rate our podcast. Go to iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, or any of your podcast providers.
We are on a new network.
I heard that.
Yeah,
we're
on this new network called KUDZUKIAN. I know it's a crazy name. It's like
sounds like kudzu.
Right, yeah,
which
like the
a
grass.
Parasitic flower.
There you go.
We're killing this game.
I am Marcus Seabury.
Okay.
I do the comics corner. Star Wars, Star Trek, Buck Rogers.
All righty.
Show my age on that one.
My name's Cardi B and I'm from the Bronx. No, we're not for real. My name is Kimber. I love pens. I love books. That is what I bring to the show, as well as cuss words for these raggedy.
On the KUDZUKIAN Network.
R&R on sports.
Every day afraid of us. You know this ain't a game to us. You strange to us. That's when we getting dangerous. Come on.
This isn't serious. We could
And we're back from R&R on Sports. So, you know what? I thought about the question that you asked me. And and here's what I think.
What do you think?
I think that there are issues and things in this life, especially in America, that do not become top of mind, do not get paid attention to unless and until somebody of the Caucasian persuasion validates that it's real. Think about it. African American people have to go through their entire lives. Almost every aspect of our lives we have to go through, and white folk have to validate us on nearly a daily basis.
Okay.
That's something we're not empowered to do on our own. And I think that the same is true with these issues. The names, all of a sudden everybody wants to get right. I heard somebody say they believe it's because when they looked at all of these protests and whatnot, they saw people who looked like them.
Okay. I can see that.
In the streets.
I can see that. I can see that being part of it.
And it meant something to them. And all of a sudden they started paying attention, because it's not like we haven't been crying out, screaming.
Absolutely.
For 400 years.
400 years. So
it's not like they hadn't been hearing that name is racist for many years. But to your point, why now? Why change it now?
So
other than the corporate pressure that they got, which is obvious.
Well, see, that's where I'm going, in that, you know, in the great words of Eddie LaVert, for the love of money.
Don't.
For the love of money. and you know, it was the NFA, not the NFL, that caused the problems. It made Dan Snyder say, wait, hold up now. Don't be so rash. We can change. We know, although just a year ago, he was like, we will never change. And when I mean NFA, that's Nike, FedEx, and Amazon. When they came in, when Nike pulled all their gear off their website, when FedEx, Fred Smith said, hey, homeboy, nah, man, it's time. It's time to make a change. And we won't be involved going forward. And I'm going to add somebody else to it.
I like that. The NFA, Nike, FedEx,
and Amazon. And Amazon pulled all that gear off their website. Now, you know, Amazon is
the NFAA.
And
Amazon.
Well, here's another one.
What?
D.C. City Council said, you will not be coming back to D.C. with that name. You're going to stay where you are.
I must have missed that.
Yeah,
really?
Yeah. The city council said you will not get those provisions when trying to move back into D.C. That will not happen as long as you carry in the R word. So I think with most corporate individuals, specifically Caucasian males, it's got to be in the pocket, baby. It's got to be in the pocket.
I agree with that.
If it ain't no change happening, see, we wasn't talking about Fred Smith didn't call before now. So therefore, there was no need to change. Nike didn't pull their stuff down before, so there wasn't no need to change. Amazon didn't pull it off their website, so there wasn't no need to change. But then when you start, when you hit them in the pocket, that's what I think as a whole African Americans got to learn to speak the language of the capitalistic society.
We used to do that. We used to do that because that's what the Montgomery bus boycotts was all about.
Absolutely.
But
there was a year and a half, I think.
I know.
It was like a year and a half of struggle.
I know. But wait. There was a year and a half of sacrifice.
Absolutely. Black
folk had to walk to work.
Right.
Folk who rode the bus to work had to find other ways to get to work, but they did it. They sacrificed. We now, the I'm not gonna say the current generation. In the current climate.
No, this is not y'all. It's in baby boomers, man. It's in baby boomers pass down that rebel DNA to us.
Oh, then we didn't pass it down.
Y'all didn't pass it down. Y'all got the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and 1965.
We bought y'all too much. Y'all were too comfortable.
Yes. Yes. See, and we was the Gen X, we were on the other side of the Civil Rights Act, which we got to see all the other side, because I can remember coming home from church with my mama's like going off like that. And I'm like, but mom, we just left church. What's wrong with you? That's not true. Billy never said that to me in daycare or elementary school or even in high school. Mm-hmm. Billy never said anything like that to me, mom. You are so out of touch. And I'm disappointed with you, Mom, because we just left church.
Was that you?
That was me.
Oh, wow.
That was me. Mm. And my mom said, boy, just keep on living.
She should have backhanded you.
No, that wouldn't. No, but it would have helped me understand where I was coming from if my dad would have been like, look, man, here's the situation.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't get any of that. Mm-hmm. We got on the other side, and it was all peaches and cream. As far as a kid coming up, it was love. But now when we got older,
you saw what the real deal was.
Love.
And I do know parents of my ilk and generation that actually tried to shelter their kids from those kinds of experiences that we had. And the experiences, you know what they're called life.
I wonder if Deadlift Shrimp, remember Deadlift Shrimp was on the show.
Talk to
and he wouldn't have him talk to his black sons.
Right.
You know,
right.
Because he just didn't feel that was right. Deadlift, I'm talking to you.
No. He left it to his wife.
Well.
That's who had to talk. Well, he didn't have to talk. He said he wasn't qualified.
Well, he was definitely qualified as his dad. It would have made even more impact for him
to say his black son. Yeah, he didn't feel. And if you don't feel comfortable, I don't want you trying to do it.
Oh well,
Mama can take that. Mama can take care.
Well, no, Mama ain't gonna walk the streets as a black male.
No, this
Mama
is true.
Ain't gonna walk the
this
streets
true,
as a black
but
male.
But she can at least start to seed the reality with you.
But that means that white man, as Deadlift Shrimp is. Decided
because he'd be talking about something he don't know, Larry.
But he's talking about something that his kids will be experiencing.
Yeah, but he does not know what that is. How authentic can he be talking to a black child about what
you
his experience
not,
is going to be as a black
be,
man? He doesn't know.
Not necessarily experience.
And then he
as
didn't
as
even
man.
Grow up in this country either. So how would he know?
No, he just grew up in the most racist country in the world, in Germany. Come on now.
Not for him.
Yeah, I guess you got a point.
It wasn't racist
corrected.
For him.
I stand corrected. But listen, man, listen. Like I said, it's hitting them in the pocket. And if we want change from the National Football League, and when I say if we, and when I say we, make no mistake about it, America, I'm talking about as a black man. If we want change, we're out of the NFL, we have to value our entertainment more than we value. I mean, we have to value our humanity more than our entertainment. And that's where we got to go.
That's
with
a point.
It.
That's
we
a point.
Have to value our livelihood, our humanity. We could have got Colin Kaepernick back in the league.
Don't
watch
show up.
It. Don't show up.
Yeah.
Colin Kaepernick been in the league last year, 2 years ago.
So
that's where I am.
Well,
that's where I am.
Colin has been vindicated by the. Has been absolved
by King Roger
of any guilt by King Roger, and to show you how understanding, empathetic, and sincere he is, they are going to begin the first NFL game of the season.
Don't make me lose my religion
with the singing of. The Negro, the African American, black national anthem.
Here's what we're gonna do.
Lift every
here's
voice.
What we're gonna
and
do.
Sing.
We're gonna go out of this segment
before they
we're gonna get out of the segment because I don't know the second segment. So I don't know the second stanza of the song, and I'm sure 99.9% of most African American men probably don't. You don't know the second stanza, do you?
What are you talking about?
Lift every
that's
voice.
That's the first thing.
And sing.
God of our weary years. God of our silent tears, thou who has brought us thus far. Oh, don't mess with me, man. We'll be back for more R&R Sports after this.
I love it, man. Teach them young bucks something. Feeling the heat up in the street,
rocking the beat. Step up in the club. Take me to. Hello, everybody. This is WNBA President Lisa Borders, working with all the good folks at R&R Sports. Let's go.
Riffin' on Jazz.
When two friends get together to kick it
about jazz, it's called Riffin' on Jazz.
Catch us Riffin' on Jazz every week right here on your favorite broadcast or podcast platforms.
Riffin' on Jazz on the Kudzukian Network. Kudzukian. Lift every voice and
sing. We're back for more R&R on Sports Now.
Back.
Now, listen. This is very, very serious. That song is sacred to some of us.
It really
okay,
is.
And
to I your to know the how point, did it become the Negro national anthem? I want to know that. I want to know
how
did it become the Negro national anthem?
Here's what I want you to do.
But here's my introduction as a Gen Xer with the Negro national anthem.
Okay.
Here's my experience.
Okay.
When WLOU in Louisville, Kentucky, mm-hmm. used to sign off every day mm-hmm. at dusk.
They would play it?
They would play
okay.
the Negro National
okay.
Anthem.
Okay.
And I used to lift every voice, and I used to sing, and that was my experience with the song.
Right.
And beyond that, every now and then it happened in church.
Here's what I want you to do. And anybody who's listening to this, if you are not familiar with all of the lyrics, look it up. Pull it up. Look it up.
All right. I'll do that.
It is as much a battle song as the battle hymn of the Republic.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Yes. Look it up. I mean, you will be glad that you did. But here's the problem that I have with the NFL. Don't play with us.
Yeah.
Don't play with us.
Well, they've been playing with us. So don't start.
How insulting is it?
It's been insulting.
But not like this.
Hold on. They took a man's job for kneeling.
I know.
They took a man's job and made him a social pariah for kneeling.
I know this.
The hell with the NFL with that.
I know this.
They've been playing with us for a long time.
Hold on. Okay. I get it. I'll go with that. But listen, and to your point, I wonder who looking like us was in the room.
They need all the taste slapped out their mouth.
They do.
They seriously do.
But listen.
Troy Vincent, if you were in the room, I'm going to go Demarius Smith on you because you need all the taste. And I'm looking dead in the camera. You need all the taste slapped out your mouth if you were the dude who suggested that they play the Negro national anthem before the game.
But
if that was you,
but
Troy Vincent,
but wait a minute, wait
you
a
done
minute,
totally
minute.
Sold out.
Wait a minute. It's not insulting. I'm not saying it's insulting because they endeavored to do it, but they're going to do it for the first game of the season, if there is one in the stadium.
That's a whole other conversation.
And there likely won't be fans there. How empty is that?
Well, of course it's empty.
How empty is that?
But you know they're going to be watching it on television. And like always, we play the national anthem on television, don't we? Yeah, right.
No,
okay,
don't.
So listen. Let's move on past that foolishness.
Okay, all right.
I want to get to this bubble, man.
Okay.
Because Bob Popovich, okay. which I respect. I respect.
That's changed too. Go ahead.
I respect Greg Popovich.
All right.
And Greg Popovich said, there's no safer place on the planet than inside the bubble at the Wide World of Sports at Disney.
Come on, Pop. Dr. Pop. Doc Pop.
But you know, hey, he and Dr. Woolery, I'm going to believe them beyond
Where has
Dr.
he
Fauci.
Been? At the Happy Trails home? He had a statement. He cut. Oh my Lord. And then, I don't want to talk about it.
Can we see what's behind door number two?
So go on with the bubble. Go on with the bubble.
Listen,
you believe it's safe?
I believe it's safe, but I believe that it will receive, there will be a lot of breaches. First of all, the most horniest times in my life were in my 20s and early 30s.
Spare us of that, please.
Well, I'm just telling the truth.
Spare us of that.
If you telling me that I'm going to go into an environment for 3 months,
yeah,
have no interaction with no females outside of the waitress and waiters and whatnot at the hotel,
yeah,
I think it's going. I'm gonna breach the bubble. If I can, it's just what it is. I heard that the great ones don't. The great ones literally they don't. They're going to be there and they're going to work really hard.
Surely don't confuse you with them.
Well, listen. I'm telling you, a young man in his 20s and 30s, early 30s, is going to find companionship.
Okay. So,
and that means that somebody's either coming in or I'm going out.
Okay. So a few players test positive. Okay.
It depends.
Hold on.
Michael Beasley, he go home. Ja Morant,
okay,
he goes home. Let LeBron.
You think it's who it is?
Oh, absolutely. AD, one of the major stars.
Here's the question.
Listen to the question.
Why does it matter who it is if they are exposed to other players? Who gives a damn who it is?
I agree with you. However, I think it will change.
And here's the rest.
It will only change when those major players get it. So I just think it has to be somebody of major note. Now, I was surprised with Russell Westbrook, and I believe James Harden had COVID as well.
Okay.
But I believe that with Russell Westbrook, it was because it was before. It was before they got there.
Mm-hmm.
So he could stay and he could take quarantine till he got, tested mm-hmm. negative. Mm-hmm. Then he could come on.
Mm-hmm.
But I think once you get in that bubble, if one of the major, major stars of the NBA gets COVID-19,
mm-hmm.
I think we're going to have a problem.
Okay.
If one of the major players breach the bubble, I think we're going to have a problem.
What's the plan B?
There's no plan B. Blow this thing up and go home.
That's right.
And I think that's ultimately what's going to happen.
Shut it down.
It's got to happen because at the end of the day, it's really asinine for us to be even talking about playing sports.
Mm-hmm.
I really do. Mm-hmm. I just think it's crazy. I mean, numbers are shooting up all over the country. We're back into shutting down. So I just have to say that if we don't get this right, we go into another lockdown. And with another lockdown, we going to need some distractions, but it ain't going to be from players playing that down in Orlando.
Change is the name of the game. That's what we're talking about. That is what we're talking about. Another thing that's changing is the series that we did some time ago, some months ago, called What If They Committed?
Oh, somebody was listening to us.
What if they committed?
Somebody was listening.
They are committing.
Yeah.
This is a series, for those of you who don't remember or aren't regular listeners of R&R on Sports, shame on you if you are not. But we did a series produced and created by our producer, Jeremy and
McKnight. Put some respect on his name, man. Don't be his name ain't Jeremy, just Jeremy. It's
Mr.
Jeremy
McKnight. May I tip my hat, Mr. McKnight. Excuse me. And I meant Jeremy, not Jeremy.
Jeremy. Affectionately known
as Jeremy.
J-Rock. That's J-Rock over there.
Okay, so their committing meant that elite five-star athletes would select and begin to choose
mm-hmm.
HBCUs,
okay.
and at least enter them into the discussion and consideration.
It's happening. I got to read what this young man said. And this is Makua Maker, Thon Maker. I think it's Thon's younger brother.
Mm-hmm.
But here's what he said. I dare to be different. Now, the question was asked by the reason behind his decision. I dare to be different. I always consider myself to be a leader. I want change. I want to change the current culture and climate that has kept five-star athletes like myself from viewing HBCUs as a viable choice. I have no idea why it's been over 40 years that not even one five-star basketball player in the United States has decided to play basketball at an HBCU, but I do know that in this Black Lives Matter moment that empowered and assembled many different people across the country and the world, that it won't be another 40 years until it happens again.
Wonderful.
Absolutely.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful.
Makua.
And
thumbs up to you, man. We are behind you 100%.
And from two proud HBCU grads.
Yes, sir.
Keep it coming. I am so happy, and I hope more and more do that and understand. I mean, I like Howard and everything, but
I went to KSU. I'm so glad. I went to KSU. So glad I went to KSU.
You did a good part. Finish it.
I can't do it.
Singing Glory Hallelujah. Woo! That's the best part. We even got the University of Memphis folk doing that. I had to tell somebody that you know where it came from, don't you?
Right, right.
Came from black schools.
Pilfering.
Appropriating. That's what they call it.
Is that what it's appropriating?
That's what it's called. That's what it's called.
Repurposing.
Listen, we have...
You got us today.
So, yeah.
And it's been
all real.
Us, man.
It's been real.
It's you and I, mano and mano. So, come on back.
We got more of this foolishness when you come back on the other side of this.
Entrepreneurs should check out Grindset because these are the stories of entrepreneurs told in the most raw, unassuming, and honest ways. And every episode you will hear things that you didn't know that will no longer scare you, and you will feel encouraged to take your entrepreneurial journey because these are entrepreneurial heroes and they'll show you the way.
Hey, baby, this is the Reverend Al. You know me. Whenever I'm riding around in town, I'm always listening to Howard and Larry on R&R on Sports.
I started to write this song about you.
This is America. Don't catch you slipping, no. Don't catch you slipping, no. Look what I'm whipping, no. This is America. Don't catch you slipping, no.
Welcome back to R&R on Sports.
Back.
I might be doing anything. This is new for us. This is new for me.
Live stream, baby.
Live. Yeah, Facebook Live. Oh, Lord.
So okay, listen, so, man. Let's go back. Let's go back to this going to HBCUs.
Go.
Because what you're finding is that a lot of these young men are now leaving these traditionally PWIs,
yes,
which is predominantly white institutions,
mm-hmm,
and they're transferring to, mm-hmm, HBCUs. I think, mm-hmm, there's been like three or four Division I athletes,
mm-hmm,
basketball players that have transferred to HBCUs,
mm-hmm,
when the last. As you know, my son is a basketball player, mm-hmm, and actually decided to go to prep school this year. But I'm really pushing for him to go to an HBCU because, number one, I want him to be protected. I want him to be in a place that loves him and cares for him.
Mm-hmm.
And on top of that, I want him to develop a relationships that exceed beyond,
mm-hmm,
college. Because, mm-hmm, see, what happens,
absolutely,
is a lot of my friends.
My wife says that all the time.
You know, a lot of my friends that went to PWIs, some of them went to entities like University of Kentucky, Western Kentucky University, and we can go on and on,
mm-hmm,
and on.
Mm-hmm.
But when they go back to homecoming, mm-hmm, as a 30-year-old, mm-hmm, and as a 40-year-old,
mm-hmm,
they're relegated to one little small section of the school, of the campus. There may be programming for African-American students. There may not be. So what I've asked is that we bring them to our HBCUs. And what I've done is literally invited them to come to homecoming, especially fraternities and those in the Panhandle. I'm like, come on over to, you know, come on over to KSU for homecoming.
Mm-hmm.
And literally, to the letter, every one of them says, man,
mm-hmm,
I wish I'd have gone to K-State. Mm-hmm. I wish I'd have gone to an HBCU. Absolutely. I wish I'd have done. And so to me, it's a matter of us starting to take pride in what we do have.
Yes.
And supporting these institutions that have that were committed, because we just couldn't go to any institution. You know, just part of that whole thing of racism and white supremacy and all that bull. So literally, we couldn't go to any institution. So that's why HBCUs exist. And that's why I believe that it is the best place for our students.
I agree. And I have heard time after time after time again, people say that, oh my goodness, that's what I missed when they went to PWIs did not have the same, to your
experience.
Point, didn't have the same experiences, did not have the same type of relationships and all of that. And these are lasting. And these are places where you are nurtured and nourished, and where
I was held accountable. Because I actually went to the University of Louisville.
As an athlete, you were held accountable.
No, as a student, I was held accountable.
Oh, I'm sorry. That's what I meant.
As a student,
you were held
basketball,
accountable.
Basketball. In fact,
because you could have been somewhere else.
My Caucasian coach told me, I can remember. And I changed my major from computer science to chemistry. And he was like, why are you doing that? Mm-hmm. You know, basketball is going to take up so much of your time. And you know, that's a pretty tough course load that you have to take, and blah, 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 blah. And I said, well, you know, I feel like I can do it.
Mm-hmm.
But what I got from my African-American professors was, I don't give a damn if you are playing basketball. You better have that lab done.
Mm-hmm.
You better have that assignment done.
Mm-hmm.
You better do it on the bus. Mm-hmm. They know they got lights on that bus.
Mm-hmm.
That don't mean you get to, you don't get to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
You better do this work.
Now, if you had gone to, how would that have been different had you gone to Louisville or?
No, I did go to Louisville for one semester. And I went to the speed school. And guess what I got?
What?
That's, you got it.
Okay.
That's what I got. Nothing.
Nothing.
Absolutely. No one cared that I didn't turn in an assignment. No one cared if I showed up to class or not.
And you got what you get? You didn't play ball, so
no,
you,
I didn't.
I was playing ball.
I was playing a techno bowl, in the dorm.
Yeah, in the student center,
would be the equivalent of 2K today.
So, speaking of 2K,
what you got?
I want to mention Kenny Got Work.
Oh, Kenny Got Work. Kenny Got Work, the number one player for Toronto's team,
exactly,
straight out of Memphis.
Right. And for those of you who don't know, this is a young man whose name is Kenny Haley. And I think he's a graduate of Westwood.
Uh-huh.
I think he went to Westwood. And he is the top Y2K NBA 2K player in the league for the Toronto Raptors NBA 2K gaming club. And he is killing it.
Yeah.
He's
nice, man. Kenny Got Work. We'll give you that work. Straight out of Memphis, Tennessee.
Straight out of Memphis. And for those of you who don't know, they are drafted just like NBA players are drafted, and they get paid
real money. I don't like Kenny.
Why not?
Because, see, my son, every time I say, get off the game, boy, it's time to go to bed, he like, but Dad, I could be like Kenny.
Oh, okay.
Gets to play all into the hours of the night.
Well,
and I'm saying, wait a minute, man. He said, Dad, I can get a job like Kenny.
I happen to know firsthand that Kenny's mama used to say, boy, same thing. Little did she know. She called me one time. This is, I believe, back in 2018.
Uh-huh.
And she called me. She said, turn on channel. Hurry up. Turn on channel. Whatever. And she said, see if you see somebody you know. And so I went turning on. I see these kids playing video games. What is this? And there goes Kenny. It's the semifinals. And they are playing in the semifinals. If they win, they get to play in the finals. And the winner of the finals splits the team. And if five young guys, five players on the team, they get to split $250,000.
Man.
And they won.
They won. That's they actually right. was the right. was the All-Star game down in New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
And Kenny got work. Got work.
And got paid.
And got paid.
did work and got paid.
Listen, so, this is R&R on Sports. And as usual, we are bringing up topics and conversations that's just probably not going to happen anywhere else in all of sports radio.
Again, name of the game has changed. So
changing, baby.
Here's what I want to talk about just briefly. I want us to follow up on the shows that we did with our good friends who are parts of the pit crews in NASCAR.
Okay.
And they're
so
the ones.
About Rocco Williams and Mike Metcalf.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I want to follow up with Rocco and Mike and see what it's like now. I want to see what it's like now since all of the stuff that has happened. I also want to ask and find out whether or not they think my theory is valid. My theory is that noose that was hanging up in that garage.
In Bubba Wallace's garage
was not targeting Bubba Wallace because they didn't know that he was going to get that. But it was, I think it was a message to the increasingly larger numbers of African Americans on pit crews.
Yeah. Yeah. I can believe that.
On pit crews. And I think that somebody wanted to try to send them a little message.
Right. Right.
That we ain't pleased with y'all being here. And
I find it really interesting that they talk about the fact that this was in the garage since early October.
Yeah.
And that there's no other garage of garage door pull strings.
No.
In fashion.
It's
that
a
way,
rope with a knot on the end of it, like most folks
like
garage.
Yeah. So it's really interesting that would be. And then to see, how people have responded by the way that the NASCAR responded.
Mm-hmm.
It's been quite alarming, but it's always like 45, he blamed Bubba.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always blame the person. Yeah, blame the oppressed. Blame the oppressed. Let the oppressed figure it out. And I'm just saying, man, come on. Come on, folks.
Well,
deal with people like you would want to be. You know, the golden rule. You know, treat people how you would like to be treated.
Mm-hmm.
To me, really says it all. And for those that can't do that, which I find it that most seem to not be able to just do that simple thing, treat me with the respect you would like, is most alarming to me because that's the one thing that makes me very cynical about this whole moment. In that, I just believe it's a moment in time that if we let up off the gas in any moment, and when I say let up off the gas, I mean these people protesting and the likes that are out there. I think if they let up off the gas, I think just like with anything else, we'll go back to what it was.
I think letting up off the gas is going for the okie doke too. So right. I think empty things and things that are don't really mean anything and won't really mean anything in terms of the betterment and for the good of our people, you don't need to fool with. Like my mama used to say, don't major in minors.
Right.
So I think we need to be very, very aware of that. And I think that anybody to the NASCAR point and to any other point, anybody who thinks that racism and racist people are punks and gonna go quietly into that good night are crazy. There's gonna be pushback. There's gonna be stuff like you've never
they're
seen.
They're fighting for a culture.
Before. They are, and they're gonna fight for.
They're gonna fight. They're fighting for a culture. And
generations. Oh, you're taking down the statues. They ain't happy, and it has already begun to be reflected.
Right, right. Well, so, man, listen. I'm telling you that. I mean, this society, and I love the name of this show and the name of the game.
It's change
because we're in the midst of a massive transformational moment. And I don't think it's all negative.
I really don't. Well, I don't either, but I got to say this.
Okay.
And we got to mention this. So we're talking about what's going to happen with the bubble and all of that.
Okay.
Let's talk about a little bit. What do you think about what has already happened with regard to the Ivy League football schedule with regard to who else called this stuff.
I mean, Big Ten's talking about only playing conference. It's Howard University has I think it's Howard. Isn't it Howard, Jeremy, that has canceled their season? The whole entire conference, the whole entire conference is
MEAC.
Yeah, MEAC and the SEAC, all of them have shut down for the whole fall sports. I mean, man, you know, going into this whole thing around players getting signed to schools and all the, I just don't see us having a very viable fall sports.
My wife was on a conference call back in April, and there was a head epidemiologist on the call. There were about 100, well over 100 business people on the call, and he said back then in April, there will be no football this season.
I can't imagine.
And she said there was audible gasp, like somebody had been announced that they were dead. Like,
wow.
So it's coming
like
to
a horror flick.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh my god. Yeah. Oh my god.
Shock. So hey, we almost out here, man. We didn't talk that much. Yeah.
No, yeah. We couldn't have. Yeah. And we ain't got nothing else to talk about.
And we ain't got nothing else to talk about.
Well, you know, we got
time to say goodbye.
Okay, well,
so
let's
we'll do that
on,
when you come
on
back.
Other side, you know, we
don't do my thing.
Oh, well, do your thing.
We'll be back for more R&R on Sports on the other side of this. You can't do it.
Don't listen to him. Listen, we'll be right back.
I like the way he said funking around.
Yeah.
That's what they're doing.
I did like that, but he said the old
I'm going to start using it.
He said the old electorate is funky.
Well, basically, it's what he's saying. He's saying that they...
No, I said they're funking around.
And that's true.
with our future.
Because it's known, and I think you absolutely...
Don't
the
let
midterm
them...
Midterm elections
don't let them
always
funk up the future.
Oh, my God.
And we are back.
Back.
So we can get out of here. Go ahead. You're sitting on the edge of your seat with something.
Well, I got a couple people I want to shout out.
You feel like must be
well, number
said.
One, I want to shout out Fred Smith.
Why?
Well, number one, I think it took a lot for him to stand up and say, look here, man, it's time for a change with Dan Snyder. Mm-hmm. I know he and Dan Snyder, from what I understand, have a good relationship, a good friendship.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what it's going to take sometimes. It's going to take... You know, those people that are standing next to those that are doing things that are improper. And friends don't let friends be racist.
Way to go. Let's see if that can stick.
Yeah, yeah. Friends don't let friends be racist. So
let's see if that can stick.
So I want to shout out Fred Smith, even though I think it was a long time in coming, considering his headquarters is in a city that's 70% African American. We won't, you know, kind of go into that, but nevertheless, I think, you know, that respect for others, somebody got his coattail, somebody said, hey, make a change, and I appreciate that. Now I'm not willing to let the Washington team off the hook, because to me, I want to see what you come back with.
Well, you got any idea what you'd like to see him?
I like to see 70 years of the Washington Pale Faces. How about that? The Washington Caucasian. Can we get that? I mean, you know, just it's only right. You know, turnabout is only fair.
Oh yeah. So you want retribution?
Yeah. You know, let's see how fighting that is. You know,
if you were bigger than that,
if I was bigger than that,
yeah. What would you want to see him call?
That's a very.
There's been a recommendation for the Red Tails.
I realize there's the connection with the Tuskegee Airmen and all that, but I think you can go with something really, really simple, like
somebody
the
just
Cougars
said the Americans.
No,
the Washington Americans.
No, because if
how about that? You like that?
No. No, not at all. Not at all. But I will say, we're going to come back next week.
The Stars
we're
come and back Stripers.
With, we're going to come back next week with some more cogent thought in regards to a potential nickname. if they haven't come out with
it. I don't plan to have Cogent Thought next week.
No, well, you don't have Cogent Thought this week. So,
so why change? Listen, we appreciate
you. I thought the show was changed.
Huh?
I thought the show was changed.
Yeah, but I'm not going to change.
Oh, okay.
We're talking about change.
Oh, okay. All right, then. All right, well,
we appreciate you being with us here on R&R on Sports. We ask that you be back with us and download the KUDZUKIAN app. I'm going.
Go ahead and do your thing. Go ahead and do your thing.
Let me do my job.
Yeah.
Download the KUDZUKIAN app where you can get all of the shows, particularly R&R on Sports. And you can check us out at will, at your convenience. We've had some wonderful shows, and you can check them all out. So.
I'm Larry Robinson, and this is Howard Robinson, and we're saying peace. We'll see you later. Holla. Arrivederci. Audi 5000.
You've been listening to a little R&R on Sports, written and produced by Howard Robinson, Larry Robinson, recorded and mixed in Memphis, Tennessee.
R&R on Sports with Henry's Hall of Fame Barbershop.
Come on in here and welcome to Henry's Hall of Fame Barbershop. Which haircut
customer
would you like? Point to it. I'm in chair one. Would y'all shut up? That's the number 12. Yes, sir. That's the Barry White. Baby, go on back there and get that lie for me.
Sit on down here.
We gonna get your hair long and pretty. How y'all like that game the other night? Did it suit you? Did the outcome suit you? What you think?
That Kerry got the worst hair of any good hair boy I ever seen in my life.
That boy talking about the main hair. Talking about the main hair. Talking about his game. What?
All he need is all Curry need is some Murray's. Curry needs some Murray's.
He need a wine silky.
Slick that stuff back in it and it'd be a beautiful thing.
Curry don't need no Murray. He need the Duke.
Need the Duke.
The Duke.
The
they
Duke.
Don't do
that
the Duke,
Duke
no
your
more.
Hair up and make it go any way you want it to go.
And speaking
I've been
of
in
bad
this business for 40 years.
I got a little cousin that could braid Riley's hair.
And speaking of bad hair, did y'all see LeBron James?
LeBron
what's
James.
The matter with his head?
He ain't got no hair.
He got tatter.
That boy do need a stocking cap. I think he need him some Glover's Moon. That's what he needs.
Glover's Moon, boy.
Glover's Moon?
Glover's Moon.
Now I use his Glover's.
Glover's
Moon.
That's the reason your hair look like it looks today.
It's Glover's Mane, sir.
Mane.
It's Glover's Mane,
oh,
sir.
Oh, that's right.
He well, got stitches
no,
in his
y'all
head.
Both wrong. I uses the moon.
LeBron is losing his hair. And it will be gone forever.
He is watching.
That boy Stephen A got the same barber.
He is washing more face these days.
And combing less hair.
Now, y'all, I do know who LeBron James' real daddy is.
That Aloysius boy. That Aloysius boy.
No, that ain't Aloysius boy. No, that ain't. I know who daddy
yeah,
that
yeah,
is.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's Jesse's boy.
Jesse James?
Yeah.
No.
Isn't his daddy in the witness protection program?
Not anymore. The boy's daddy. Now, y'all listen to me now.
Well.
The boy's daddy, LeBron James' daddy name is Rick.
Lord have mercy, boy, you just
Rick James.
Don't
Super
put that on Rick.
Super freak.
Come on, come in here. Freak. I used to come in here with that white guard named Tana.
That's right. That's his real daddy. A lot of people don't know that.
Is he biracial?
Biracial. No, Rick wasn't biracial. He liked women.
Hey, this is Shaq Adocious. And when I'm in town, I'm always listening to Howard and Larry on R&R on Sports.
Welcome to Motivational Moments from the Greater Cliche Fellowship Assembly,
where everything sounds like you've heard it all before.
He's the Reverend Repetitious R.Y.
And he's my Deacon Redundancy Brown. Now, you know, friends, just when you think this life is a slam dunk, something can come out of left feel and go oops upside your head. Say oops upside your head.
The bigger the headache, the bigger the pill. The bigger the pill, Reverend.
Bad luck and heartache can pin you against the ropes. They don't pull no punches either. They hit you with everything they got. Everything but the kitchen sink. Beat you like a runaway slave.
Kunta or Toby or one of them.
And then you might go down.
Down goes Frazier.
Down goes Frazier.
But you got a friend who'll let you be down but not out. You got a friend who won't let you be down for the count because it ain't over till it's over.
Wow.
It ain't over till that big, wopty, greasy, fat lady sings.
I like big butts and I cannot lie.
You other brothers can't deny.
My baby got back.
And that's when it's good check time. Don't let them throw you under the bus.
Mm-mm.
Remember, the best defense is a good offense.
Absolutely.
Get in the game.
It's in the game.
Don't hate the player, Pastor. Hate the game.
Why drink from the bitter cup of defeat when you can enjoy that sweet taste of victory?
Victory.
Sipping on some gin and juice.
Laid back.
The ball is in your court. And it's time to swing for the fences and knock it out the park.
At the wall, see ya! Just throw your hands in the air and wave them like you just don't care.
Now, if you do these things, friends, I guarantee your good luck and prosperity will go through the roof.
The roof! The roof! The roof is on fire! We don't need no water like the mother!
This has been another motivational moment
where everything sounds like you heard it all before.
He's Deacon Redundancy Brown.
And he's Reverend Repetitious R. White from the Greater Cliche Fellowship Ass.
That's Assembly, fool.